Good afternoon. My name is Leo Groenewegen, CEO and co-founder of Cellular Revolution. At Cellular Revolution, we are trying to revolutionize the way cells are grown. We're using novel techniques to create better, more efficient bioreactors. The vision of the company is what we are trying to do. Well, as a company, we like to say we are bio-inspired, employing a continuous cell growth process, which is also found in nature. Example here always is the fact that humans, animals, we do not grow cells in batches. We grow cells continuously. A good example of this is that you don't wake up tomorrow morning with, say, 100 million or a billion cells of just available to do whatever. But actually, every minute, every second, cells in your body are growing, proliferating, and becoming whatever they need to be and go where they need to be. Cells can become muscle, fat, anything. As a company, we're trying to take inspiration from nature. And after that, we have been able to design a continuous cell growth process, which is moving away from the traditional batch-based bioreactor processes. Generally speaking, with any type of technology, being able to move from batch to a continuous system, no matter the industry, has always provided large benefits. Technically speaking, our technologies can be used by anybody trying to grow cells at scale. A priority, of course, is cultured meat, as this will have the biggest impact on the world, on society, on sustainability. But technically speaking, we could also sell our technologies to companies developing biologics, cellular therapies, artificial blood, and so on. Also here, of course, cultured meat in this context pertains to sort of all cell egg technology. So whether it's real meat, as in beef or pork, whether it is, for example, fish-based products, or actually things like leather, fur, milk, and so on. So, I mean, many people here today will, of course, know what is the difference between sort of conventional animal source meat and cultured meat. And there's a few, of course, benefits. It's very clear that animal meat, for example, has to deal with environmental issues. Here, you're of course looking at CO2 emissions, greenhouse gases, deforestation, and so on. On the other hand, of course, health concerns are also a big issue. This could be related to, for example, bacteria on your products, microplastics in your fish, and of course, zoonotic diseases. Biggest issue, well, for many people, of course, is ethical issues. Technology has advanced so much over the past few years that actually slaughtering or killing animals to produce food products is something that is not necessary anymore. We have vegetarian, vegan options. Now cultured meat is coming. So the ethical issues can really be overcome. Cultured meat, I mean, how is it made? Well, again, lots of you people here will know. Generally speaking, you will start with taking a aspiration from the target animal. In this picture here, it's a cow. This could be a pig. It could be a salmon. Could be any type of animal, basically. After you take these cells out, you put them in an initial bioreactor for the proliferation phase. In the proliferation phase, the goal is mainly to go from, say, the 10 million cells that you collected to going to 100 million or billions of cells. So really creating many, many cells. Once these cells are sort of fully proliferated, you can further on go into the process of sort of sorry, not expanding them. Of differentiating them, for example, into fat or muscle tissue, putting them, for example, on scaffolds to make sure you get the right texture. And then you can go to the food processing stage where you can either combine different cell types together, but also combine, for example, cell-based products with plant-based products, and then make your burger, your sausage, your steak, whatever you're looking for. The market opportunity for cultured meat is huge. It's still an extremely nascent market, but it's a market that over the next few years will develop extremely rapidly. And if you really look at technologies, markets that are going to make an impact in the next sort of few decades, cultured meat is one of the top markets. It is still in most countries not approved. We are expecting, though, I'm expecting to get at least small scale market approvals in the US and probably also in the EU somewhere in 22 or otherwise just inside 23. So what are the main challenges of cultured meat? But the first challenge I always like to bring out is scaling. We've been running the numbers at the lab ourselves, and we have calculated how many cells we're going to need in the next few years per annum to sort of feed the world or feed the demand of cultured meat. So this number is approximately 10 to the factor 20. For many people, that doesn't really say much. It's kind of it's a number, but what is it actually? What does that mean? Well, it either equals all the grains of sand we have on planet Earth, or all the stars in the currently observable universe. So it's really a huge, huge number, which is very hard to grasp. And it really relates again to the need for efficiently scaled production of cultured meat. Current technologies. I mean, there's many technologies out there to produce cultured meat. There's many innovations going on regarding novel types of serum, novel types of bioreactor, novel types of scaffolding. So a lot of the B2B companies like Cellular Revolution are actually really trying to innovate, making sure that we can create cells at scale and not just only create those cells and produce these cells, but also can do that sort of cost efficiently and sustainably. In the case of adherent cells, a big problem often is the available surface area. Looking at current conventional bioreactors, there are just issues with scaling, issues of growing enough cells within them. There's the issue of serum, which by many of the companies have already been solved, so that it's slowly moving to the background. But of course, then the issue still remains that in many cases, the media mixture or the media solution is still on the expensive side. Looking towards the future, you see that with current technologies, you really cannot really keep up with the demand that we're going to have in the future. So you can see on the right-hand side that there really is a need for more efficient methods, more efficient bioreactors to actually produce all these cells that we're going to need. And that is also where Cellular Revolution and our novel coating and our novel bioreactor actually would come in. So what is going on? Looking at scaled facilities for cultured meat, I mean, there's been some different numbers running around. It just, of course, announced their facility to be costing $200 million or up. Other people have quoted a factory producing 10 kilotons of cultured meat will be costing around $450 million. I guess depending on the location of the facility, the used infrastructure, the used CapEx tools, this will be anywhere in between, basically. Again, it shows that if we really want to produce a lot of cultured meat, if you want to produce at scale, there is a huge scaling issue, not just related to the equipment that we need, not just the facilities that we need, but also, of course, the capital cost, the amount of money that needs to get invested to actually produce these costs. And then after that, of course, the OPEX cost of actually running these plants, running them efficiently in a manner that cultured meat could compete with conventional meat and with plant-based alternatives. So what have we produced? What is our solution to this problem? Well, we have developed a novel type of bioreactor that is capable of continuous cell manufacturing as opposed to conventional batch processes taken from the sort of pharma biotech industry. We do this by combining a novel peptide-based coating, which allows for single-cell self-detachment. And this allows us to create a novel type of bioreactor that is able to produce much more efficiently. So our bioreactor allows for serum-free continuous cell manufacturing. It's fully closed and automated, keeping it safe and efficient. We can significantly reduce the footprint of the bioreactor because our bioreactor is so much more efficient. That would mean you either purchase fewer bioreactors and have the same output, or purchase the same amount of bioreactors and have a much higher output. Here we are looking at a 2.5 to 3 times efficiency gain as compared to conventional batch stirred tank bioreactors. Fewer bioreactors, for example, would also mean you need less media, you need less energy, you need less members of staff, you need less facilities, so everything sort of trickles down and makes it more efficient, basically. So what's the difference between continuous and batch? So on the top right side, let me play this video, you see a coating surface, cells are growing, seeding, proliferating. And in the moment they're fully grown, individual cells are detaching from the surface. New cells take the place of the old cells. They will grow, proliferate, detach from the surface. It really creates this ongoing production cycle. In a batch system, this is a bit different. Again, you have a surface. Cells are initially getting seeded on it. They will grow, proliferate. Once they're fully grown, normally you get like a chemical like trypsin or something to cleave them. Clean out the bioreactor, you have downtime, and you so start this process again from scratch. This downtime especially is somewhere where you, with a batch system, of course, lose a lot of time and a lot of production effort. On the right-hand side here, you can see a way of comparing this. This was a study we did a while ago with our initial proof of with our initial prototype. Data in newer versions are slightly different. Generally speaking, you can see that with a continuous system, we can produce more than 2 times the yield. And this was a much smaller bioreactor as well. So we had about 4 times smaller bioreactor, and we're able to produce more than 2 times the yield than the batch system. And this depends, of course, on the types of cell you're using, depends on the amount of downtime you have. But in this model, at least, it shows clearly that using a continuous system is many times more efficient. So our technology allows for a move from batch to continuous cell production for cells. Again, looking at other industries, chemical industries, car industry, doesn't really matter always. There's proven that continuous production, ongoing cycles of production are more efficient. The combination of our peptide-based coating plus bioreactor allows us to do so. On the right-hand side, again, you can see the manufactured cells you can do looking at batch versus continuous on an annual basis, but this also works on a yearly basis, on a half-year basis or a X amount of months basis, is about 2.5 times. So that's the amount of cells you can create more if you look at the same kind of setup. So what is then the benefits? So the clear benefit is an overall reduction in cost of goods for a price-sensitive consumer market, of course. We can allow companies, the B2C culture meat companies, to scale up their production, to produce a lot of cells, produce them much more efficiently than conventional bioreactors would. Which in terms, I mean, if you again look at the facility that costs anywhere between say 200 million and 400 million or even more, on the CapEx side, for example, just at the initial stage, the savings by using our technology can be several tens to even maybe $100 million of dollars just for the CapEx. And then of course, as it requires fewer bioreactors, as it requires bioreactors produced more efficiently, the overall OPEX are also going down. So also in the long run, every day, every month, every year, you'll be saving cost on your facilities. This also leads to a resource reduction, which is important as you need like less energy to operate the bioreactors, meaning you can produce much more sustainably, which is also very important for your footprint and for your end product, of course. The system being sort of largely automated, largely producing continuously, means also you have a steady output of cells, meaning you can sort of build an entire sort of production line, a production facility, based on this steady output of, for example, say 10 million cells per hour, just as a number. And then because you have this amount of cells coming out, you know how many cells you can differentiate, then you know how much fat, how much muscle tissue you have every hour, every day. And then you can set up also later on your plant for like your packing plant, you actually plant where you, for example, combine cells with, say, plant-based ingredients. So every step of your production process can be built and optimized on that, making sure you have a very steady, predictable output of product. As a company, we have submitted 2 patents back in 2019, which was specifically on the design of our peptide-based coating. We also put in further application regarding specific bits and pieces of our bioreactor design. And of course, as a company, are always developing new ideas, new technologies, and are also striving to gain sort of additional IP protection where appropriate. So, Cellular Revolution was founded by myself as a CEO, Professor Jay Conlon as the CTO, and Martina Miotto as the CSO of the company. Further part of the management team is Dr. AJ Tarakan, who is our senior bioprocessing engineer. He's really responsible for moving the bioreactor from current sort of having multiple prototypes to actually being able to sell our MVP mid next year. Martina, she is a CSO, is mainly leading our lab and cell-based activities. And Jay is the CTO and gives us the technical background. Our members of staff here, we have four employees, which is a mix of scientists and engineers. And we've actually just recruited a few additional members of staff who will be joining our company shortly. More importantly, we are currently actually recruiting. We are looking for two R&D scientists to join our team to actually work on the cell biology, to actually do a lot of the research. Very interesting as well to many people maybe out here, which might be one of the most interesting roles currently available in the sort of cell ag space, is that we are recruiting a chief of staff. Anybody here in these few days that sees this video, sees my pitch, feel free to contact me. If you're interested in any of these positions, or if you think these three positions might not be right for you, but you want to do something else in the company, reach out to us, let me know. So Cellular Revolution as a company is a spin-out from Newcastle University, and we have received support initially from them to set up the business, to spin out the IP, become a company. We've had several grants over the past few years. Innovate UK, Northern Accelerator have both helped us actually building, setting up the company. And we have received investments from companies like Northstar Ventures and CPT Capital, which have been very important for the growth of our company. What's interesting to see as well, at least for the investors, we are currently working on a safe note where we are aiming to raise between 3 and 4 million pounds before the end of this year. If you might be interested in a innovative B2B company that works for the cell and with the cell or cultured meat industry, please do reach out, let me know, and I'm happy to take a call. Thank you again for your time. We are Cellular Revolution, and we are revolutionizing the way cells are grown. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.